Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. Amma ba'd. Ahbabti fillah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says fi kitab al-kareem, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu qu anfusakum wa ahlikum naran wa qudaha an-nas wal hijara. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says fi kitab al-kareem, O you who believe, ward off from yourselves and your families the fire, whose fuel is men and stone. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala warns us to protect who? Ourselves and our families from the fire. So it shows us that we have a mas'ul. We have a mas'uliyah, that we have a responsibility. And I want to point this out because when we look in our society and we look at the scenarios, the various scenarios and the problems we have, especially in the West, but in fact, you would be surprised how many Americans and how many Westerners we know that were raised in Saudi Arabia, and especially their girls turned out to be some of the worst. And this is a lot. We're not talking about one or two occasions. We're talking about many sad cases of young girls growing up in the Saudi society, embracing the materialistic culture, which is very prevalent there, and doing very bad things that I'm not even going to mention. Wallahu musta'an. And so, ahabati fillah, it shows us that we, as parents, have to be hands-on in our approach and raising our children. And one thing I want to point out, I know so many people, so many Muslim brothers and sisters, that they have their girls are just immersed in the society. They're working, they're this, they're that, all totally entrenched in the society. So then how is it that you think you can protect and preserve them? You gave them certain values, yes, but they're mixing in every, in at the job, at the university. And let's say if you do some of that out of maslaha, out of a great need to do so. But the problem is, it's not establishing any boundaries. The girls have no hijab. They have makeup on. They let their daughters and their girls parade around the society. So where is your mas'uliyah? Where is your responsibility, your sense of responsibility, which will come back to you? And how many of those fathers are devastated now because their girls, Muslim girls, have boyfriends, non-Muslim boyfriends, Muslim boyfriends, everything in between, all the other ills that affect all the other communities, they affect us. So it's very important. Also, it's important to know, what are your children indulging in? What are they watching? If they watch movies, or if they, you can't even stop. Everyone has a device, some sort of social media account. Who are they talking to? What are they engaged in? So it shows us the importance from many different ways, because the shaitan comes how? He comes through two ways, as Shaykh al-Islam ibn Taymiyyah mentioned. The first way, ahabati fillah, the shaitan comes, he comes in these two ways to you. He comes in two ways. First, a shubahat. A shubahat, ahabati fillah, we're referring to out of doubt things. This could be an issue in aqidah. So then, how many kids do we know that the parents gave importance, and especially this affects the Somali communities, that they want their kids and they force their kids to go to the Duksiga Quranka, to go to the tahfid for memorizing the Quran. That's beautiful, but they don't give them anything else in the deen. So their kids are not prepared. They don't even know the aqidah of Ahl Sunnah. They don't know anything about the deen, about anything about basic fiqh of tahara. They don't know how to wash themselves to make istinja a lot of times, but yet they have memorized the Quran and probably forget it. So this is upon the parents to take a full concern to the best of their ability. We know that we're busy, but to be concerned with the religion of the children and to cultivate them. Because the shubahat, as we mentioned, the ways of reading on the internet and on the television and the newspaper and everywhere, you're bombarded with things that are un-Islamic. Either it could be from the point of bid'ah, or even it can be the point of kufr. Look at all those girls, look at the girls around the world, but I can think of a specific example of some younger girls who are about high school, middle school age, I believe, in the UK, who went to go join Daesh, those evil Takfiri Khawarij groups, okay? They, obviously, their parents didn't know who they were communicating with and what they were involved in, what their social media. These girls were known for being good girls in school and beautiful young Muslim girls studying, doing their thing. But what was going on behind closed doors, the Shubahat was attacking them, that they had Khawarij and Takfiris who were in the pictures of, you know, portraying themselves as defenders of Islam, who were actually deceiving them and calling them to the Sabila Shaitan, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said would happen, that he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam drew a line in the sand. And he said, as the hadith goes, خَطَّ لَنَا رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ خَطَّ. The Prophet ﷺ drew a line. He drew a line in the sand. وَخَطَّ عَلَى يَمِينِهِ وَعَلَى شَمَالِهِ. And he drew one on the right and he drew one on the left. وَقَالْ. When he drew the first one, he said, هَذَا سَبِيلُ اللَّهِ. This is the path of Allah. And then he drew one on the right and drew one on the left. He said, هَذَا هِي سُبُلُ. Those are the paths. وَعَلَى كُلُّ سَبِيلٍ فِيهِ شَيْطَانُ كَمَا قَالَ النَّبِي صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم said, on every path, there is a shaitan who calls to it. So we have Ahl Bid'ah, Ahl Zandaqa, Ahl Kufr, Ahl Ilhad, calling your children away from the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah صلى الله عليه وسلم. May Allah help us. May Allah protect us. May Allah preserve us and our children. Amin ya Rabbil Alameen. The second way that the shaitan comes to you is through shahwat, through desires. This is, Habibti Fillah, a great, devastating danger. And the reason I say that, because it is so, you know, if someone has the aqidah, the correct aqidah, they can still be jarred off the path of the Book of Allah and the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, or go into major sins because of the shahwat, because of the desires. So, for example, the shaitan makes the desires appealing to you in the various ways and paths and forms. And all of us have desires. All of us, from our fitra, we have shahwat. We have desires that we want to fulfill. And we fulfill them, emma bil halal or emma bil haram. We either fulfill them by halal or we fulfill them by haram. So that through the shahwat and not knowing what your children and others are looking at, as one Jew was describing, he was a rabbi, he was talking about the fitna in the Jewish community that they don't want to talk about, and that is pornography. That he said that it's as if, you know, before you could protect your children, but he said nowadays when the children close the door, it is as if they have closed the door to a brothel, to an online brothel, meaning that the door is closed now, and what your girls, what your boys are looking at and involved in, webcamming and every other thing that has gone to the fullest of extreme of shahwat, it's there now. Now it's almost impossible to protect your children from this. So it comes with the importance of giving continual tarbiyah, continually stressing to them and trying to build them a foundation and keeping that religion. That's advice to myself and to you, to keep that in your household, and do not neglect your family, because your family is in need to protect themselves either from the shubahat or from the shahwat. And they're both incredibly dangerous, and both of them are present in our time in ways that we can't even begin to articulate, because it is so severe. Wallahu musta'an. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says fi kitab al-kareem, ya ayyuhalladhina amanu qu anfusakum wa ahlikum naran wa quduha an-nas wal hijara. O you believe, ward off from yourselves and your families a fire whose fuel is men and stones. Bin Baz then said, paying attention to the affair of the prayer is from the reasons for protection from the fire for both the parent and the child. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, addressing his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, وأمر أهلك بالصلاة واستبتروا عليها. And enjoin the prayer on your family and be patient in offering them. Because it takes patience to pray 5 times a day. That takes patience. It's not easy for everyone. Everyone, because we have busy lifestyles and we become so distracted from all the things in the dunya. So it requires effort. It requires striving to please Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and to do His commands, tabaraka wa ta'ala. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, command your children to pray at 7 and beat them concerning it at 10 and separate them in the bed. So here, these are qawaid of responsibility, but qawaid of how to, of dealing with and raising one's children. These are principles, in fact, of raising the one's children, because the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, command your children to pray at 7. So here the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is telling us that we must command our children to pray and spank them, if you will, at the age of 10. And separate them in the bed, meaning that we separate the males and the females, especially that they become more cognizant of their bodies and the differences between their brothers and their sisters, the difference between the opposite sex as they get older. So you separate them in the bed at 10 to make sure, you know, the males and the females, they should have their separate places in their own privacy as the girls begin to develop, as the boys begin to develop. So they need that separation, they need that privacy, they need that which is going to help them deal with their changing nature and their changing selves. So the child, whether male or female, is to be commanded to pray when he reaches 7 and beaten concerning it when he reaches 10. This is because at this point he has reached and drawn near to maturity. When he attains puberty depends upon the individuality of the individual, and it becomes obligatory and binding upon him, and he deserves, if he abandons it, to be commanded to repent. So if he repents, then this is good. Otherwise, he faces the consequences. So the affair of the prayer is major. Hence, it is obligatory upon the mothers and the fathers, the elder brothers of the children, and their uncles to cooperate in this matter and strive hard in rectifying the children and cultivating them Islamically. And from that is making them hold fast to the prayer and commanding them with it when they reach 7 and beating them concerning it when they reach 10 and fall short in that. So this shows us that Islamic cultivation that we have to maintain in our households. Likewise, they are to be commanded with what that which Allah commands them with, from righteousness towards their parents, and safeguarding the tongue from abuse, cursing, and lying, other than that from sins, from that which Allah the Mighty and Majestic has prohibited. Likewise, that they are prohibited from consuming intoxicants and smoking, so that they will not grow up upon this falsehood. So it is obligatory upon the fathers and mothers to give attention to the children regarding that which benefits them in the dunya and the hereafter, and is upon them to prohibit them from that which Allah the Mighty and Majestic has prohibited them from, so that they may grow up with a righteous upbringing, so that they will be upright upon the religion of Allah. So when they reach puberty, they will know that which is obligatory upon them and which they are prohibited from, and they are cultivated upon doing good and upon leaving off evil. Then their father, their brother, their mother, and whoever played a role in this good will have the likes of their reward, as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, he who directs to good will have the likes of the reward of the one who does it. And we ask Allah the Almighty to accept our good and forgive our evil. Wa sallallahu wasallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wasallam. Thus ends our reading of this very beneficial treatise of Imam bin Baz about the importance of raising our children, which we can never, ever underestimate, because they are the future of Islam. They are the future of your family. You are responsible, as the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commanded, and as a, and the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam let us know that we're all responsible for our flocks. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala rectify our condition and the affairs of our children. Ameen ya rabbil alameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us success in this life as well as the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us, preserve us, cure us, guide us, increase our rizq, bless us with ilm al-nafi, rizq al-tayyib, wa amal al-mutakabbilin. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala save us and save our children from the hellfire. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam.